We are done with our line plot and our bar graph. So in line plot, what we were doing, we were drawing the lines using x and y point. Similarly, in bar graph, what we were doing was we were drawing the bars using the points, x and y points. There were a few customization in that. The few customizations were like, you can, for the bar, you can change the size of each bar, you can color the bar. Similarly, for line also, you can change the color of it. You can give some different colors to both the lines. And so on, you can change the line style, you can change the line width. So similarly, we have the third plot in the category, which is our scatter plot. As the word says, scatter means that everything is distributed. So you can see the image over here. The image has already been shared with you on the slide. That image is clearly an example which shows you that how the scatter charts look like. You can see the dots over here, 1, 2, 3, 4. So this is your way of representing your scatter plot. If we talk about line plot, then how does it represent that a line will be drawn using this point, and that will be your line plot. Similarly, if we talk about bar graph, then the bar will be standing just above on the points wherever the data points are there. On that data point, the bar will be drawn up. So if you talk about scatter graph, here no bar will be there, no lines will be there, but only points will demonstrate that where are the data points over there in the graph. So now a scatter graph can be drawn using two methods. One is the plot method and another one is your scatter method. So plot method, you will see plot. We generally use plot method for drawing the line, and bar method for drawing the bar graph. Similarly, if you want to draw a scatter graph, you can use plot as well as you can use scatter, both the methods. Now, when you use plot, we already know that it draws a line. So if you write this plot without line style argument, then it will draw a scatter graph for you. Also, you cannot change the alignment of your x and y. After x and y, you have to always say the marker type. If you change its place, then the marker type, it will again result into a line. So the marker type should be always written after x and y, and then any color whichever you want to give. But it should be without your line style argument. Now see, plot function can also written without line style argument, and then also you get a line. The only thing which you have to do if you want a scatter graph is that the third position should always include your marker type. Which marker type do you want? Then only you will get a scatter graph using this. But maximum of the time, this is just a way to show you that by using plot also you can draw scatter graph. But usually scatter, for drawing scatter graphs, we use the function plot, plt.scatter. Why we are using plt? I think you must be aware about this already, because PLT is an acronym which we are using instead of matplotlib.pyplot. Because we already defined it in the starting of our program that import matplotlibrary.pyplot as PLT. So that's why I'm using here PLT.scatter. So PLT can be anything whichever you define in your import statement. I usually define PLT variable, that's why I'm using here PLT. So plt.scatter, and then you can pass your x and y axis data. Suppose if I have two data, then I can always pass array 1 and array 2 as my x and y. By default, first data which is being passed will be taken as x, and the second data will be considered as for y axis. Then you can, there are some more attributes associated with it. You can write the marker size, you can always say the marker color, you can always say the marker type. So what actually marker means? Marker means this point. So you can change its size, you can change its color, you can change its shape, all can be changed. This is your marker. These dots are representing your markers. So let's see one of the example of this. Okay, before going to the example, you will see the customization of it. With how many things is available for us to customize the graph. So there are some things like adjust color of the scatter points. Whatever the points are there, as I've shown you here, these are the scatter points. So here by default they are in blue color, but if you want to change the color of them, you can always do it using C. You can write color also, and you can use C also. Utilize the C argument for the scatter method for coloring. So you can always write C, or you can clearly write color is equal to green. Similarly, C in the previous picture, it was like a dot. So you can always use any marker type. In the previous slides, which has been already shared with you, I've given you all the marker types, which marker types are possible. You can have a loop over there and you can choose whatever marker do you want. If you want a plus marker, that is also available. If you want an O marker, that is also available. So you can always write your marker type. Now see, I'm not writing here as marker type. I am just writing marker, so that is also okay. You can simply write marker and which marker are you using with it. So first of all, we were discussing about the color. So I can just simply write the color over here. And if I write only one color, that indicates that I want all the scatter points to be in green color. Now, why I'm saying like this? Because we can even give a list of colors also. Suppose if I want red and green color, I can always pass them in the square brackets because then it becomes the list. So I can always pass with multiple colors also. So if I pass two colors, but there are 4 points, so it will be red, green, red, green. If I want to pass 4 colors, I can always pass red, green, blue, gray, whatever you want to pass. In that way, all 4 points will be having a different color. Similarly, you can change the size of the scatter plot, that scatter graph, that scatter points, that means, let's see, here all the dots are of same size, but you can always change the size of each dot. You can represent the different sizes. And if you are representing only one size, that indicates that you want the same size for all of your dots. But if you want to a different kind of size, you can pass it like this, that one should be 20, another should be 60, and so on, whatever the sizes do you want to put it. Next, we have an adjust the transparency of the scatter plots. That means you can always adjust how dark or how light do you want to look it like. So there is an attribute which pass on like is alpha is equal to 0.5. So alpha is equal to 0.5, or you can change the value for it. It lies between 0 to 1. You can write any point for alpha. It will change the transparency of that particular marker. This is a note for you that C is being used for colors here. S has been used for size over here. If you do not want to use the acronym, you can directly write color and size. If you want to pass the sequence, you can always give it into this. And if you want to combine both of them into one single argument, you can always write it like pat.scatter, array1, array2, then color, and then size. You can also write it like size before you are writing and color afterwards you are writing. Everything is fine. Because you are already mentioning them that the C is for color, S is for size, which is like this. So let's see one of the examples. This is a very basic example in which the first statement we have is import matplotlibrary.pyfloat as pat. Why we are writing this? Because you are working on matplotlibrary, and in that we are working on pyplot module. That if you will write only matplotlibrary, then it will by default import pyplot also because it is a module of it. But why do we need to import the complete matplotlibrary? It has so many functions inside it. It's better to import only that which we are requiring. That's why I've written .pyplot. I want only pyplot module because I'm working with only pyplot. Now, instead of using again and again such a huge name, I just wanted to use this name as PLT. That's why I'm using the PLT. Now this is my one of the list. This is my another list. So now my X axis and Y axis is all ready. All data are ready. Now as already discussed that if you want to label it, that means if you want to put some names over the axis, you are going to use label. X label, Y label. X label will label this values over here. You can see in the picture A values. Y label will plot it here, B values. And then you can always give the title to the whatever you have made. The title function has been there. So you can use it like pat.title. And whatever the title you want to put it. So I'm using scatter graph using plot. As I told you, there are two ways to create scatter function. Two ways to create scatter plot or graph. One is using plot, which we usually use while drawing lines, and another is using scatter graph. Plot will not be using much, but just to show you the usage of it, I have taken one of the examples in which your first argument should always be x-axis, second argument should always be y-axis, third argument should always be your marker type. If you write it anywhere else, it will result into a line chart, which we do not want. We want a scatter graph using plot function. So you have to use your plus or any other marker. So third argument will always be your marker type. Then color can be passed, marker size can be passed. And one more thing which we are not passing is our line style. Because if we will pass line style, then it will again draw a line. So this is the first way how you are using your plot function to draw a scatter graph, in which, again repeating, first argument should be your x-axis, second argument should be your y-axis, another third argument should be a plus, that means a marker type, which marker do you want. And then the last statement, which is very necessary to write, which is plt.show. If you not write .show, your graph will not appear. So if you want to see a graph, you have to always use plt.show. If you do not write it, itna bhi sara upar define kar do, will not be visible, because you have to always use your .show function. Show function will show you this graph, plotting of the graph and the values of it. So this is one of the way how you are using your scatter graph using plot, how you are using plot function over here. Now we'll be seeing how do we use our scatter function, which we are mostly going to read in this complete today's class. So the second example says that if you want to draw scatter graph and using scatter function, then you can do it like import matplotlibrary.pyplot as plt, the very first statement and very important statement, which will enable you to work in this. Second, you have passed arrays, array 1, array 2, and I have even defined arrays list. It is not necessary to do it like this. You can directly pass here also the list, but it is good if you pass it over here. It depends on how clean do you want to keep your code. If you want to pass it directly over, you can do it that also, but then it will not look that clean. It will look so messy, because here some lists are being passed and here also some list has been passed. It's better if you define it before. So colors, and I have 4 points, and I have given 4 colors for them, that I want each color to be each point to have a different color. So I've given the different colors over there. And if you do not give different colors, and if you specify only one color, then by default that color will be applied to your all scatter points. Then you have defined the sizes, that I want 50, 120, 140, 80, whatever the different size do you want. Also, if you give only one size, by default it will be the same for all of the scatter points. Now you define the color, you define the size, we have x and y axis both. Now we want to draw the graph. So I will be using plot.scatter, passing array 1. That means array 1 will behave as an x axis, array 2 will behave as a y axis, and then colors. So colors is having all this list, and sizes and marker. Ma'am, that R, B, G, T are colors names. Yes, they are color code. I have given a previous PPT in which I have mentioned the marker types and also the color code in one single slide. Go through them, that what are the color code used for different colors. Also, it is not necessary to use color code. You can always write the full color over here. Now see, R is here for red, B is for blue, G is for green, but what about K? So K is for black. Not always necessary that B will be for black, because B is already there for blue. Ma'am, how are the sizes measured in pixels? That you do not need to worry about. That is all matplot libraries work. If you will be looking for the pixel value also, it will all become into a mathematical calculation which you do not have to look into. That's why you are using the matplot library function. That will automatically do it by itself. If list color has only 3 elements, then it will again repeat the 4th color. See, I told you that if only R and B is there, then again it will, for the 3rd element, it will again repeat R. For the 4th element, it will repeat B. So if only 3 colors are given, K is not given, then for the 4th one, it will again go near the R, first position. I hope that would be clear to you. Okay, so now we have the scatter graph, which is having array 1, array 2, colors, sizes, and marker. Now, marker S is a square. That's why the shape has become like this. You can always go to the previous PPT. It has one slide which is saying marker type and as well as color code, which will make you again more clear that what are the color codes used for different colors and what are the markers used for the different marker shapes. Now, title, plotting using scatter. The title is always appearing over here. Also, you can write the X label, Y label, which I have not mentioned. You can always add legends. For adding a legend, again repeating, for adding a legend, we have to always label it into the scatter graph. The comma label will be equal to whatever do you want to give the value to it. That will appear as your legend over here. And then the last statement, which says plot.show. Now see, this time I have not included legends, ticks, X text, Y text, variable, so many places, because I do not want to really focus on them. That was already covered in your previous slide. So many times I have taken just the main functions which we should focus on for now. But that doesn't mean you should forget about them. Now see, you can see that whatever the chart I have prepared is not actually looking good, because it does not have the legends, it does not have the X label, Y label, at least X label, Y label and legends should be there. Then only it will look a better option. So if it exam, it appears like write the code for drawing a scatter graph and having the data values as like this, they will not definitely say you again and again to write the X label, Y label, but that completely depends on you. It will mention it will look good and the appearance will be better. And in fact, the graph drawn will look better. So now this is, now see, as I was telling that if you get an exam, here I was doing it with the, arrays, but what if generally if in exam, the question comes like they are giving you a data frame's values and they're asking you to, using that data frame columns, draw the scatter chart. So in that case, how are you going to do that? So I've taken one of the examples for your help so that you can understand it better over here. So if a data frame has been given, they will not give you a data frame already made. They will give you just data. Using that data, the first step will be that you have to create a data frame. The second step will be there that if you create a data frame, then from the data frame, you will be taking two columns, and then for using two columns, you will be drawing the scatter graph. You can see the example. In the questions, I have not printed the question over here, but the question was like, the data was like this. The data was already given to me and they asked me to prepare a data frame, and then from the data frame they wanted me to draw a scatter graph in which the axis should be speed and meter. You can see when the data is already given to us, when we create a data frame, we have to first import the pandas function. So import pandas as pd. Since we are working on graph, we'll also import matplot library, and then the data was given to us was this. So you can see it is in the dictionary form, key and its values. So whatever the keys are there, that becomes the columns. That means they wanted us to take this column and wanted to us to print this value. So first of all, the first method we say is that first convert it into the data frame. So pd.dataframe is the syntax used for it, and the data can be passed to it. Now see, in data frame creation, you can always pass the column name and the index value. That is optional if you want. If you do not want, by default, the column values will be speed, meter and weight. So the data frame has been created. Now see, print df, but the output is not visible over here if I'm printing it here, because print df will print it on the console. You can see I have just cut it down. The console was here just below it. On the console, the data frame was printed. If you want, you can just omit this statement for now, because I'm only showing you the graph. But if a question sees you to print the data frame, you're always you have to write this statement, and this statement will always be printed on the console, not on the plot. So print.df, and now what I am printing, I wanted to make a scatter graph for speed and meter column. So how I'll pass the speed and meter column? I'll pass it like this, because this is the column of a data frame. And if you want to access any column from the data frame, this is the method how do you access it. Or if you do not want to use a square bracket, you can always use dot operator. I have repeated it, I think, n number of times. That should be now clear in your mind by the time. So plot dot scatter, because we are drawing a scatter graph, and the function says dot scatter should be used if you are drawing scatter graph. So plot dot scatter, and what do we want? I want the column of speed and meter from data frame, and data frame is our df. So what do I want? See, why I'm writing df not x, because x is a raw data. जब डेटा फ्रेम को मैंने कन्वर्ट किया तो इट वॉज स्टोर्ड इन टू द डी एफ. दैट्स व्हाई आई एम यूजिंग कि डी एफ का स्पीड कॉलम एंड डी एफ का मीटर कॉलम. दैट मीन्स डी एफ डेटा फ्रेम स्पीड कॉलम एंड डेटा फ्रेम मीटर कॉलम आई वॉन्ट टू ड्रॉ. सो स्पीड विल बी एक्स एक्सिस एंड मीटर विल बी वाई एक्सिस. वॉट एवर द फर्स्ट आइटम इज रिटन इन टू द स्मॉल ब्रैकेट्स, फर्स्ट वन इज कंसिडर्ड एज योर एक्स, अनदर वन इज कंसिडर्ड एज योर वाई. सो पीएलटी डॉट स्कैटर एंड यू कैन सी शो इट विल गेट the output will be visible like this to you. Again, X labeling, Y labeling has not been done by me, but when the question comes, you have to definitely do, give the X label, Y label, give the legends to it, give the names to it. Okay, so this is how you can create it using data frame. Now, second question says that I want again a scatter graph from the data frame only, but the column name should be meter and weight. It should not be speed and meter, but it should be meter and weight. The only thing will be changed that instead of speed, we will write meter, instead of meter, we will write weight. Because now x axis is meter and the y axis is the weight. Then as you write plot.show, you can see the output over here. So this will be how the scatter graph will work. Any doubts till now, you can ask me, then we will be moving on the histogram then. Any doubts post scatter graph? This is the question which is usually asked in the exam or even for your practicals also, the same question is being asked. This is the example of your book only which I have taken. So that you can get it clear that if data frame is there, how can you deal with the data frame? They can ask you for the same that this is just not the matter of scatter graph, but they can ask you the same to do with line graph or to do with the bar graph. The only thing will change will the function name will change. The same way the data frame will be created, only the function name is going to change. Because x and y axis are always the same, only here instead of the scatter, if you're doing for line, it will be plot. If you're doing bar graph, it will be dot bar. So no doubts. If you have doubts, you can ping it into the chat box or you can unmute and ask me. Okay, so moving on to the histogram. So we are done with our line graph, bar graph, scatter graph. The third we have was the fourth one we have in the categories of a histogram. So what is a histogram? It is a graphical representation which organizes a group of data points into user-specified ranges. Now this is a bit tricky or difficult to understand. What does it mean? Histogram looks exactly like bar graph, but in bar graph there are so many spaces in between the bars, which is not so in histogram. I'll show you an example of histogram. Histogram is completely dependent on the beam. And beans are the values, like interval of values. Beans are the values, specified range of values are said to be as beans. So whatever the data has been given to you are first divided into the beans and then it has been drawn. So everything in histogram depends on your bean. Beans are the specified range of values or a setup, not exactly the setup, but like from 10 to 20, that means that particular group is your bean. I'll just show you into the next slide by the picturization like this. But before we go on this slide, we'll just go to the parameters of histogram. It says that plt.hist will be used. So for, again repeating, for line plot is used, for bar dot bar is used, for scatter dot scatter is used, for histogram dot hist is used. Now then the data are being passed. Then the bean thing is passed, then the cumulative is going to false or true, his style and the orientation. So these are the five arguments or attributes which are being passed with the hist function. So in this data is the array of sequence, whatever data has been given to you. Beans, now see, it is the interval on which the data is to be plotted. Whatever the interval has been given by you, if you do not give any interval, by default, it will be generated by matplotlib itself. Then the cumulative, do you want a continuous frequency to look like? If you will write cumulative is equal to true, then it will give you a continuous data sequence. If you write false, it will not give you any continuous data sequence. Hist type, you can always define that which histogram type should be drawn up. First one is bar, simple bar. Second is bar stack, that means one above another. Two bars are stacked one above another. Next one is a step which generates line plot which is unfilled. So it will be which is unfilled. I'll be showing you the programs that will make you more clear how does a step look like. The step will generate the line plot that is field. Now we have one more attribute to it is orientation. You can always give orientation as horizontal or vertical. If horizontal do you want to give it, it will be bar h, which stands for bar horizontal. If you want to give a vertical, then you can always write orientation is equal to vertical, so it will give you a vertical bar graph. So let's just see how beam works first of all. Because beam is the major part which you need to understand for drawing a histogram. So suppose they have given us this array. Now, array is already given, but on the x-axis, always the beans values are there. That means interval has been given to us. So suppose if beans is equals to given 10, that means we have to take, do not use annotations. So if beans is equal to given 10, that indicates that whatever the data value you are taking, it should have a div of 10. So let's just see. We will see that 25 and 22 are the two values. So that is lying between 20 to 30. And they have given beans is equal to 10. That means we have to take interval of 10. So it will be 20 to 30. So 20 to 30 is having a distance of 10 values. Similarly, the next bin will be having 30 to 40. Next will be having 40 to 50. Why they are having a 10 minutes of interval between them? 10 points of, because we have mentioned beings is equal to 10. So in that case, 20 to 30 ke beech mein aapko dekhna hai that how many values are lying. So according to that values, your histogram will be drawn. Now see, this is what I was telling, histogram and bar difference. If bar would be there, then it will be different on 22 point, it will be different on 25 point. But see, if we talk about histogram, it is a continuous showing data. It does not have a space in between them. It is like shown up like this continuous bars stacked over one another, not over one another, but stacked together. This is how your beings are working. If you specify beings is equal to 10, they will take the interval 10 and they will see how many values are lying inside it, and they will draw the histogram on the basis of that. You can see that from 80 to 90, there are not a single value. You can see over here in the histogram that 80 to 90 has been left blank. Nothing has been there. And then 90 to 100, again 91 is there. So then from 90 onwards, again that will be drawn up. So this is how the histogram works on the beam. Now if you give only one value, everyone will be having equal distance between them. But if you give a list of beams, then that beams will be according to that. That data will be drawn on the basis of the beam. Now we have a doubt. What if I want to have lines which separate each bar? Then you can always use, there are some customization of it when which you can always use lines, line masks, which I have not used it for now. There are some customization which we can have it, which we'll be going through. But before going through them, we can just see how first the functions work. Only 10 minutes are remaining. We'll be rejoining the meeting because we don't have so much of slides, but each slide needs a bit more than explanation. Rejoin the meeting once again. So this was how our beams work. Now I'll just show you in the examples how does it work, how the different functions work. So if, see, in the before example, the beams were given as 10. So that's why they are taking the interval as 10, 10, 10. But what if they pass the beams value like this? 0 to 25, 25 to 50. Then they are indicating that you have to see the values in between them. 0 to 25, 25 to 50, 50 to 75, like this. So if we have an array, one more thing, the np.array, because I have the values only given and I want to pass in the histogram array. So if I'm using np.array, I have to always import numpy with it. Import numpy as np. So it will be equal to np.array and the different values that I want to pass on it. Then now I have the values in a, comma, and the beans has been given. So on the beans, on they will see that between 0 to 25, how many values are lying, 25 to 50, how many values are lying. And on the basis of that, they will draw the histogram. You can see that you can, if you stretch a line, it will come between 20, it will come just nearby 20 to somewhere, because the next step, the next bar will be changed on 21st of position. It shows us that 0 to 25 will be one interval. So this one bar is our 0 to 25. Next bar is our 25 to 50. Then we have 50 to 75 and 75 to 100. And inside this, the values, as we have already shown, that if two values are there, according to the two values, the bar will be shown up. If four values are there, then the width will be according to that. Height, it does not matter, because histogram completely works on the beam and the area, how much will it cover. It does not depend on the height. So this, if the beams are there, this is the way how you are going to use it. Suppose now there is one more argument which goes with it, is cumulative. So if by default it is false, but if you write cumulative is equal to true, and if you pass it into the histogram argument, then you can see the change of the bar graph. So it will be like continuous, whatever the changes at each interval of time will be shown up like this if you put cumulative is equal to true. There are some questions which say that draw a normal histogram using this data, draw a histogram with cumulative argument. So how do we do it? This is the way of doing it differently. The next is, if you are mentioning histogram type, that it should be step kind of. So that's what I was telling, in step datagram, histogram, it shows you like this, which is kind of line, but which is unfilled, which is not at all filled with color. So if you mention his type equal to step, it will look like this. If you mention it his type equal to bar, which is by default, it will look like bar. You can mention it into the bar stack also, then it will look like this. You can see if we have a histogram type as bar stack, then A and B are all stacked over one another. So before moving to that, we'll just see his type equal to step looks like this, which only shows you steps and all the histogram is not filled. Next we have is if you're drawing the histogram using two arrays. Till the time you were taking it only one array was the one we were taking, only one array, sorry. Now we are taking up two arrays. And plt.hist A, B, and we can just draw it. You can see the output, how will it look like. Similarly, if we have histogram time is bar stack, it will look like this. We can just mention it into the argument that this type should be equal to bar stack and it will look like this. Next we have is, again, we can combine our hist type and cumulative together. So if we combine it, it will look like this, that because cumulative is a continuous frequency and hist type bar stack is stacked, one bar is stacked over the another. So it will look like this. So only thing what is changing, everything is same, only your arguments are changing. And if you change the argument, how the graph is changing, I'm showing it into a different program. And the last one we have is orientation is equal to horizontal. By default, it is anyway vertical, but if you want it into the horizontal, you can always mention in the hist function, you can always mention orientation is equals to horizontal. So you can see the output over here that the horizontal has been here, the bar has been printed here horizontal. So these are the different ways how we can use your histograms. The last slide we have is our frequency polygon, in which what it actually shows how the frequency, how much frequency is there for each one. You can see over here that along with the beams, we are also discussing what is the frequency of this. So if you want to find out the frequency of a polygon, the only simple thing is that all the process will be the same. The only thing which is different over here is that, see, you have the different histogram already drawn over here. If you want to find the frequency polygon of it, what you have to do, the steps are like, you have to find out the midpoint of each beam, because this is a bin. So you have to find out the midpoint of each beam or each bar, and then you have to just connect them to make a polygon. So that is how your frequency polygons are being connected and are being made. So this is the way how it is being made. The first, only you have to see that all the midpoints are connected, and if the first data is there, it should always be connected to the midpoint of your data values. And the last also should be connected to the midpoint of your intervals on x-axis and x-axis. So this is how your frequency polygons are being made. This we are going to discuss in the next class, not for now. So this is what we are done with today's class. But before we go, we have to just see the journal questions also. Only two journal questions are there, in which already have given one as a data frame has been given, and you have to draw the scatter chart. Columns are 1990, 2010 for one graph, for second graph 2010 and 2000. I already shown into the slides how to do it. The next question you have is, you have to draw a simple histogram for above data, a horizontal histogram for above data, in which we are only going to put horizontal orientation is equal to horizontal. Next we have a step type of histogram. You have to draw a hist type is equal to step. And then we have a histogram in which you have to just put cumulative is equal to true or false. Ma'am, what all chapters will come for the UT? Unit 1 is going to come, which involves your all the pandas, which involves your matplotlib library, your pandas, in pandas, your series and data frame operations, everything. So according to the new syllabus, the first unit which I have taken from series, everything is going to come. I'm not involving your MySQL, but series, data frame, then your matplotlib library, all this are going to come for your first UP. So this is what we are all done with today's lecture. Do no need of joining it again. If you have any doubts, you can just ask me now. I'm unmuting you all. We have 2 minutes left. Any doubts?
Oh, ma'am.
Go and try to call the program. Okay, then have a good day. Practice at home. Get back on. See.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, have fun. Bye.
Thank you.
Bye, ma'am.